So our final category of interspecific interaction, let's look at parasitism. Parasitism is the most devious and evil thing we can be thinking about here. Let's tell you about some little stories that you might otherwise never heard about. Did you know that moths flying around, minding their own business, if you look in a microscope, inside their ears, they have little mites that are sucking their little moth blood. Or look at this. This is a fish that has had its tongue replaced by a crustacean. Okay, this larva of this crustacean managed to swim into the fish's mouth and eat the fish's tongue and then plant itself on the floor of the fish's mouth. So every time this fish eats now, the parasite has first dibs at whatever comes inside. Okay? Now, if you think those are pretty evil, wait for this one. Sacculina, okay? Innocent looking little thing. It looks like a tiny little crustacean. It's a kind of barnacle. And this is its larva phase, okay? Swims around, almost like a flea or something in the water. And it infects crabs, okay? Now, a female Sacculina infects the crab, okay? And then she promotes the crab to grow this mushroom-like chamber. So it's like a tumor being produced by the crab under the instruction of the Sacculina parasite, okay? Now, once these have formed, a male Sacculina arrives, finds this, and once he gets inside this mushroom thing, he loses his legs, he loses his eyes, he just becomes a testicle. And all he is now is a source of sperm for the rest of his life inside the female who's infected the crab. Okay? Now, if the crab, the original crab, the host that was infected, happened to be a male, okay, it's now a robot under the specific instructions of the Sacculina, okay? And it starts behaving like a female crab, okay? And it lays eggs, but the eggs it's laying, Sacculina eggs. So it's been completely taken over and working solely for the good of the parasite. More examples of this. This is a little cyst that is infecting a snail with an unpronounceable name, okay? And we're going to look at the life cycle of this parasite, microphallus, as it goes between the snail and a duck, okay? And you have the adult form in the duck, and you have the cysts in the snails. So, the adult produces eggs inside the duck, so the duck poops out the parasite eggs. These are then absorbed by the snail, okay, and these form cysts in the snail, okay? And then the snail is going to get eaten by the duck. Now that sounds simple enough, but what actually happens is that as soon as the parasite infects the snail, it castrates it. So now the snail is producing no resources for eggs or sperm. All of its resources are now available to the parasite for producing cysts in the snail, okay? The cysts cause the host to climb up on rocks. Snails don't climb up on rocks unless they're infected with these cysts, okay? And the ducks come out at the exact time of day, in the morning, that's when they like to forage, and they eat these infected snails, okay? And then goes through their digestive system, you've got the adults in there, they lay their eggs, and the whole thing is repeated, okay? Diabolical. It gets worse, I guess. This is a cuckoo, okay? And you have this innocent, sweet-looking little reed warbler, all right? And you got this nasty cuckoo. And they lay their eggs in the reed warbler's nest, okay? And their egg is somewhat camouflaged. And it's very hard for us to, and the bird, the reed warbler, apparently, to tell the difference between a cuckoo egg and the reed warbler egg. This is brood parasitism, okay? So here is, in fact, the cuckoo's egg. It's got the same kind of markings, but it is slightly larger. But it's good enough to fool the reed warbler, okay? Now, the cuckoo's egg is in with the reed warbler egg, and the cuckoo hatches first. The cuckoo hatches first, and before this thing even opens its eyes, it's blind. It has no sense And yet, automatically, as soon as it's hatched, it starts doing this backwards movement, and it shoves out any other eggs that happen to be in the nest, okay? Killing the reed warbler's own eggs, leaving the cuckoo as the only baby in the nest, okay? Grows up into this huge, whacking great monster, okay, who gets fed by the dumb parent, okay? So there is the reed warbler who's sort of thinking, wow, Junior, you're awfully big for your age. So, but that's a parasite, okay? It's not just birds, but fish show a similar kind of behavior. In Africa, there are a number of lakes that have these phenomenal mouth-brooding fishes where the fish pair up, the female lays her eggs in the male's nest, and then he proceeds to keep the eggs, the fertilized eggs, in his mouth and looks after them. But there's a parasitic fish that manages to lay its egg amongst the host's eggs. And the same thing as with a cuckoo. The catfish eggs hatch first inside the dad's mouth, okay? And then they proceed to eat his babies, okay? So now this good father is brooding a parasite inside of his mouth, okay? So that's brood parasitism. So brood parasites take advantage of the parental behavior of another species to get the reed warbler or the mouth-brooding fish to raise their babies for them. Now, ants have taken this kind of goodwill and hard work of other species to yet another level. This is the slave-making Amazon ant with an unpronounceable name. The important thing about this is look at those pincers, those mandibles. They can really hurt if they bite you. Now, they use those when they raid other ant colonies and they kill them, okay, and they can carry away their pupae. But these Amazon ants cannot dig their own nest or forage. They can't feed themselves. So what they have to do is find pupae of another species and have them grow up to be their workers. Okay, so here are the Amazon ants raiding a formica nest, grabbing them, and then the formica become the workers, and they do all the work around the house for the Amazon ants. And this has inspired one entomologist to write this rather lovely passage, that while in the home nest, the Amazon ants sit around in stolid idleness or pass the long hours cleaning themselves and burnishing their ruddy armor. But when outside the nest on predatory expeditions, they display a dazzling courage and capacity for concerted action. I mean, it's almost like a video game with some nasty Roman slave drivers who go off and steal it from other tribes. Okay, now I'm going to get to a particular disease. And I want to talk about the ecological consequences of parasitism. And the disease we want to focus on is called Rinderpest. It's a virus. It's closely related to human measles, but it is a disease of livestock. And Rinderpest causes horrific disease and death, very fatal in hoofstock. Now, Rinderpest came to Africa during an Italian invasion of what was then Abyssinia, but is now Ethiopia, back in 1887. So this tapestry shows the Italian troops who were coming to invade Ethiopia. And they brought supplies with them because they knew they were going to be having battle for some time. And that included living cattle. And some of those cattle happened to be carrying Rinderpest. The Rinderpest then entered the continent of Africa in 1887, and it rapidly spread all the way down to the Cape of Good Hope in southern Africa in just 10 years. It also went out to West Africa and everywhere in between. And in those 10 years, this disease, Rinderpest, killed 90% of all the hoofstock. That's all the cattle, goats, and sheep, plus a lot of wild ungulates as well, across the entire continent. It was a devastating impact of a disease on an entire continent. Now, in the Serengeti, we've had people counting the number of wildebeest and buffalo for the last 50 years. And it's very interesting to look back at the period of time when Rinderpest still raged in Africa. Rinderpest started in the late 1800s and continued in Africa till about 1962-63 with the advent of a vaccine. And with the vaccine, Rinderpest was eradicated from the Serengeti National Park. And let's see what happened then to the wildebeest population. There's the wildebeest. Numbers are over here, and that's black. Versus the buffalo. Numbers are over here, that's green. So there were about 250,000 wildebeest during the time of Rinderpest, and about 25,000 buffalo. Once Rinderpest was eliminated, the populations grew exponentially. Wildebeest made it within only about 15 years to over 1.5 million animals. The buffalo went from about 20,000 to nearly 80,000. So these two populations were clearly held well below their carrying capacity by the recurrent Rinderpest outbreaks. So we see that parasites are devastating not only at the individual level, turning individual hosts into robots so that the robots lay the parasites' eggs, but the impact of a parasitic infection like Rinderpest can be sufficient to hold the entire population below its carrying capacity.